يتدبرون القرآن
ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا
أفلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. Welcome to the program, and we're still in the most virtuous surah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ever revealed in the last revelation, in the last message to mankind, Surah Al-Fatiha. This surah, actually this chapter in the Quran, if we spend a year or more or the rest of our lives trying to explain and to extract the benefits from this beautiful surah, we won't give it its full rights. Why? Because this is the most virtuous surah, the most virtuous that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed, as we heard from the hadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Throughout all the revelations from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to all the messengers of Allah, this is the most virtuous. Only seven verses, that in these seven verses, all what you need to know in general and all the meanings that are present in the Quran, you would have all these meanings in general in Surah Al-Fatiha. So that's why if we just explain Surah Al-Fatiha in depth, we basically need to make the tafsir of the whole Quran as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed it, since all the beautiful meanings, it's there in general terms. Inshallah, tonight we'll speak about the verse number 3 in Surah Al-Fatiha, which is Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. And this beautiful verse in the most beautiful surah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed, it means the most gracious, the most merciful, or the most beneficent, the most merciful. Talks about the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We mentioned that when we talked about Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Now it's repeated again, but in the surah, after the first verse, which is Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. So Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim here, it's referring to one of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He is Ar-Rabb. He is the owner. He is the sustainer. He is the owner of all things. He is the provider, and He is the one that has the life and death is in His hands. Everything is controlled by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in this third verse in Surah Al-Fatiha is referring to the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Rabb, is the Master, is the owner of all things. And this ownership and the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala within itself, you would see and witness, and we should witness the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in it. The name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ar-Rahman, and we talked about it before, the most beneficent. That means in itself that He is the most merciful subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's an attribute that refers to the being of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ar-Rahim, when it comes to the action, the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is witnessed in the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, as the ulama, they say that the attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with regarding to the name Ar-Rahman, this is for everyone, for all the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the believers and the disbelievers. And this is something in this life is very apparent and very clear. Ar-Rahim, it's a special mercy, and the special mercy is only for the believers. And this is something that the Prophet ﷺ mentioned in the authentic hadith, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created 100 parts of mercy. But this is different than the attribute of Allah. This is a creation of Allah. One of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He is the most merciful. But in the hadith that I'm mentioning now, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created 100 parts of mercy. One part of it that is on the face of earth, that how people are relating to one another, the mercy that a person would have towards another. Each human being has some effect of this mercy that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created, you would see something and you would feel that merciful feeling inside of your heart towards someone else, towards the creation of Allah, towards another human being, to the extent of which, as the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, that an animal would lift its foot so that it doesn't hurt its offsprings. This is from this one part of mercy that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created on the face of earth. And there are 99 parts of mercy that is kept in the Day of Judgment. For who? For the believers. Only the believers would receive this mercy, the 99 parts of mercy in the Day of Judgment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Choose the great mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's how the believers, they should be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He had given them the opportunity to subject themselves to this great mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So one part of mercy that everybody is subjected to, and that refers to the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ar-Rahman. You would see that the sun, for example, does not refuse to rise for the disbelievers. It's for everyone, the believers and the disbelievers. The provisions from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the air that we breathe, the food that we eat, all the different good things that we have in this life, it does not discriminate between the believers and the disbelievers. It's for everybody, for the animals, for the plants, for everything that has a soul, that everything that is alive, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provides for everyone. And this is something that gives us the meaning and the feel of what is the meaning of Ar-Rahman means. That the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encompasses everything. And as a result of that, the disbelievers, they have from this mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that they're able to live and eat and be happy and so on and so forth. But this is for a reason. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created in such a way in this world that we live in so that the people, the human being, would turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to subject themselves to the other part of mercy, the special mercy to the believers. That what comes with the meaning of Ar-Rahim. That the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the materialistic things that they have on the face of earth supposed to direct the human beings to the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to submit themselves to the creator of the heavens and the earth. And that's why Al-Islam, the religion of Al-Islam, is a mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's the other type of mercy that all human beings need to subject themselves to it. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. That the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام was sent as a mercy to all mankind. As a mercy to all mankind. To the believers, we know why. Because whoever believes in the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, follow the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he is saved in this life and in the hereafter. And it's also for the disbelievers, because once the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was sent, then there is no more punishment on the face of earth that would overtake the whole universe or all the people that are living on the face of earth, the same way it was before in the messengers, before the Prophet ﷺ. So the two parts of mercy, if it's correct to say that, one, it's for everyone, and everybody should witness this, whether it's believers or disbelievers. The second part of mercy that refers to it by the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ar-Rahim, the most merciful, and that is a special mercy for the believers. The believers, they witness this mercy in this face of earth, and in the Day of Judgment, they would have this mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would bless them and would make them enter the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam himself, when he said that, in the meaning of which, none would enter the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by their own deeds. Our own deeds and acts of worship, no matter what we do, it does not avail to be in such a worthy acts of worship that would make us deserve to enter Jannah. We do not deserve. Why? Because we commit sins. We have deficiencies. And this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us. Unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would shower us with His mercy. And this is something even the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said with regarding to his own self. إِلَّا أَن يَتَغَمَّدَنِ اللَّهُ بِرَحْمَةٍ مِّنْ. Unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will encompass me with His mercy. So this is basically what a Muslim is in need of. We subject ourselves to the mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because we are in need of it. If we do not receive this mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are perished. And that's why, how can we receive this? By following the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Quran, and the sunnah of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, إِنَّ رَحْمَةَ اللَّهِ قَرِيبٌ مِنَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ, that the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very close to who? To al-muhsineen, the good doers. So this is by itself a bounty from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to us, so that it shows us how can we receive this vast mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by being among the good doers, those who have ihsan, those who have goodness in their actions. They worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, and they follow the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they stay away from the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade them from doing, and they are steadfast on such a path till the moment of death. If we want to get an example that makes things easier for us to understand, although we would not be able to comprehend the vast mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith something that would bring the meaning closer to our minds. The Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, and this is something that is reported by Imam al-Bukhari رحمه الله and others, there was a woman among the captives, and she had her child with her, and she lost her child, and she was in state of panic when she lost her child. And then when she found him, she held her child and brought him close to her very tightly. And the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, watching this, and he said to the companions رضي الله عنهم, asking them a question. He said, would you think that this woman would throw her child into the fire? The companions radiallahu anhum, they said, of course not, O Prophet of Allah. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said to them afterwards that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have more mercy towards you than this woman towards her child. The mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so vast. You can never have mercy towards your own self more than the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala towards yourself. Why? Because He is our owner. He is the one that created us. And He is the one that knows best what is benefiting for us and what is evil for us. But we need to subject ourselves to this vast mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is what we need to get when we recite in Surah Al-Fatiha, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. This surah, as we mentioned before, it's something that we recite every day so many times. If you're standing in the salah, one of the pillars of the salah is to recite Surah Al-Fatiha. For every rak'ah, at least 17 times Surah Al-Fatiha is being recited every day. So when a Muslim is saying Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, as if we are saying, O Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we need to have this mercy. We subject ourselves to this mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that brings the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our hearts. But this verse comes after Rabbil Alameen, the Rabb, the owner, the creator of the heavens and the earth, to show that everything that is created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we need to witness in it the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that we would worship Him alone subhanahu wa ta'ala and be obedient to Him. So what is the difference between the effect and the meaning that Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim would gives in Bismillah Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, and when we say Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim as a separate verse in Surah Al-Fatiha? There is differences. As the ulama, they say, when you say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, you need to have the effect that by the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I'm about to recite the Quran, I'm about to eat, I'm about to do whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to do. A person might be a sinner, might have some deficiencies. So the shaitan might whisper and might tell to this person that you're not worthy. Your prayers, your worship won't be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so you remember that you are making your ibadah, your dua, your recitation of the Quran for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to the most merciful subhanahu wa ta'ala. That He forgives all sins, but people need to return to Him alone subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the person would seek some help so that he would recite the Quran and start the acts of worship. And then when he says Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the most perfect way as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught us, and then he would say Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, this is another feeling here that fills the heart with the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we need to subject ourselves now to the mercy of Allah that is apparent in all of the creation of Allah, that we get this meaning when we said Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, that in all of the creation of Allah, we would see this mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Two names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the attribute of Al-Mercy, which is Ar-Rahma, and there are many ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, many incidences among the companions of the Prophet ﷺ of how the effect of this verse and the effect of the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, the most merciful, affected their lives and how it should affect our life. Inshallah, we'll continue with a little bit more in the next segment. Until then, inshallah ta'ala, we'll see you right in a few minutes.
أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ.
So this is an open invitation for everybody to recognize God and enjoy His blessings in this life and His mercy in this life and in the hereafter as well. Allah, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim. Each name has a meaning. Each name signifies a nature of Allah the Almighty which no one shares or is compared to Allah in it.
فَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ.
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. We're still with the third verse in Surah Al-Fatiha, الرحمن الرحيم. Two names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the attribute of mercy. And with the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the perfect names and attributes. No deficiencies in the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing is the like of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He's the all-hearer, the all-seer. Human beings, they have mercy that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put in the hearts of the human beings, and they need to develop this mercy. And to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with regarding to this mercy, to have mercy towards one another. And this mercy is nothing compared to the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nothing is the like of Him. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said in the authentic hadith, and this is a hadith Qudsi, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that His rahmah surpasses or come before His anger. We know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is angry with the disbelievers. And in the Day of Judgment, this is mentioned in many of the evidences in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, that the hellfire is the place where the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is served. And this is basically the perfection of the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the mercy comes first, as it's mentioned in the hadith at Qudsi. The believers, when they depart from this earth, they depart from the agonies of this earth, this life, and the pain that a person would go through throughout his whole entire life, to the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam mentioned in the hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, that when people die, either they would have a form of relaxation, if it's correct to say that, they would transfer to the state of comfort, and other people will be in state of comfort as a result of them departing from the face of earth. The believers, the Prophet ﷺ, he said that he will be saved from the agonies of this life to the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imagine the meaning of this. And if we ponder over this meaning, that a person is departing from this life to where? For the believers, to the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is so vast. And that's why, as it's mentioned in some of the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, that the believers won't want to come back to the face of earth after they depart from this life, except only the martyrs. They would wish to come back for what reason? For them to fight in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that they are martyred, so that they would receive this great honor as a result of being martyrs for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But when it comes to the disbelievers, people are saved by the death of the disbeliever when he dies. Why? Because the presence of the disbeliever brings the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the less virtue and the less benefit that a person would get as a result of the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is also, and again there are many evidences in the Quran or in the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, that shows the effect and the signs of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you would see in the Quran, in some of the verses of the Quran, it mentions the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the creation of Allah, in the creation of the night and the day and the sun and the moon, and the different things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provides for us. And you would see also in the Quran and in the hadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, that the religious meanings, the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is by itself a mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we would see that, for example, that the Quran is a mercy from Allah. And we need to witness this. We need to deal with the Quran, that this is the mercy that has been revealed to the Prophet ﷺ. Because how can a person subject themselves to the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without getting to know the Quran, the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, قُلْ بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ وَبِرَحْمَتِهِ فَبِذَلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُوا. That means that it's by the bounty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His mercy they should rejoice. That brings the happiness in the life of a Muslim, that when we witness the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam mentioned the authentic hadith that a man among the people of the children of Israel, when he killed 99 human beings, and he wanted to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sincere repentance. And he went and he asked a worshipper, someone that is a monk, for example, and he's worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he thought that he has knowledge and he went to ask him, would Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept my repentance if I repent to him? He said, no, he won't accept your repentance. So he killed him. So they become 100 now. And then he was told that there is a scholar, a knowledgeable person, go and ask him if you have a chance for repentance. So he went and asked him and he chose the virtues of the people of knowledge. The person of knowledge told him, yes, who can deprive you from the repentance and from the forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but you need to go and travel to so and so village, because in this village or in this town, there are righteous people, those who are worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you need to be with them. You need to have the company of those who are righteous to help you to be steadfast in your state of repentance. So as a result of that, he repented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he traveled, and on the way, the angel of death came to him to take his soul. And the angels, they were of two groups. The angels of mercy, they wanted to take his soul because he repented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the angels of punishment, they wanted to take his soul, meaning that he will be punished as a result of the crimes that he committed, such as a severe crime. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent an angel, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best, but it's for us to learn from this, and for this to be witnessed for or against the human being. He sent an angel as a judge between them, and he told them, measure the distance between the town that he left, his town, and the town that he is wanted to reach. If he's closer to the town that he was in, then the angels of punishment will take his soul. If he's closer to the town that is having the righteous people, then the angels of mercy will take his soul. And when they measured it, in one of the narrations of the hadith, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the earth then shortened, in which he was made closer to the town of the righteous people. And as a result, the angels of mercy, they took his soul. It was mentioned in the hadith, in one of the narrations, like in Sunan al-Imam al-Tirmidhi rahimahullah, that this person, while he was dying, كان ينوء بصدره, which means he was trying to get closer to that righteous town with his chest, although that won't benefit him. Won't benefit him whatsoever. Why? Because he's dying. What's the movement of his chest to go forward would do for him? But it shows the truthfulness that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made in his heart. It shows the vast mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to his creation. Also, the Prophet ﷺ, he taught us to have mercy even to animals, and there are examples of this. The Prophet ﷺ said in the authentic hadith that a woman, she entered the hellfire because of a cat. The small creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was the reason for a woman, a human being, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the heavens and the earth, for this human being to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How much the human being is honored, but still this woman entered the hellfire as a result of what? As a result of abusing a small creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is hirra, a small cat, as the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam mentioned in the authentic hadith. Also the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and this is in Sunan Abi Dawood, that a camel complained to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And this is from the miracles of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. A camel complained to him that his owner tied him up, and he complained to the Prophet ﷺ. And the Prophet ﷺ, as a result of that, he spoke to this individual in some tough words to tell him to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with regarding to these animals. These animals do not have the ways to express themselves. And the Prophet ﷺ told them that you should fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with regarding to these animals. And it shows how the mercy of the Prophet ﷺ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to have such a mercy. This is something that you won't find in any place on the face of earth except in the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. perfect revelation, Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, that we are ordered to show this mercy and to have this mercy in our hearts and in our actions towards the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also ordered from the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As I mentioned before, the prophethood by itself is a mercy from Allah, so that the human beings are not left to be led astray, but instead they are ordered to follow the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by the teachings of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, the one that teaches people to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, the one that teaches the people to be kind to one another, to be truthful, not to lie, and that he forbade anything and everything that is evil. You would find it all there, in the perfect way of life, in the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, to the extent of which, that he said alayhi salatu wasalam, man rahima walaw dhabihata usfur rahimahullah. This is an authentic hadith in Sahih al-Jam' and Sheikh al-Albani rahimahullah ta'ala authenticated it, which means whoever has a mercy to even the smallest thing that we're supposed to slaughter, if we want to eat from it, like a bird for example, if he has mercy towards this thing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will have mercy for such a person. To that extent, any form or any type of mercy that a person show to any of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the result is given from the same sort of deed that a person would do, and that is, he would receive the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Many ahadiths, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that a person would enter Jannah if he has three of his offsprings, they die when he was alive, and even two, as it's mentioned in some of the narrations. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would make such a person, and for women, that she would enter the Jannah as a result of the mercy that she had in her heart towards her children. So when a mother has that mercy in her heart towards her children, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward her for that. So nothing is wasted actually in our life. When a mother is taking care of her children, when the child, for example, is sick, and you would find this feel of mercy that would be present in the heart towards the young child, this feel of mercy, the person is getting rewards for it. And that is by itself the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which directs us basically to seek this mercy and to have this mercy towards one another, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before that ordered. And this was something very clear in the lives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the companions radiallahu anhum. You would see in the stories and the biographies of the companions radiallahu anhum, like Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, Umar, Uthman, Ali, the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the many incidences that has been reported to show and to for us to see how much mercy they had towards one another. For example, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, after he became the Khalifa, the leader of the Muslims, after the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he used to, before that, he used to milk some of the goats for some of the poor people. And this is the humbleness that they used to have radiallahu anhu. And this was before he became the Khalifa. This was at the time of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. He would go to the poor people and some of the widows and so on, and he would milk their goats for them. And after he became the Khalifa, some of these widows and some of these poor people, they said, now Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he won't do the same. Why? Because he's now the leader of the Muslims, the head of the state of the Muslims. How would he come to our homes now and milk our goats? He was doing this for the sake of Allah. He was rich, as we know from the history of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he had his own trade and he was rich among the companions of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, but he would do this humble act for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. When Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu heard this from them, he said, no, by the name of Allah, by Allah, I would never quit such a deed. And he would still, radiallahu anhu, after being the head of the state of the Muslims, would still go to some of the poor people and milk their goats. And this is the examples and the effect of these companions radiallahu anhum reciting the book of Allah and living with the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And this is what we need to develop. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam also said in the authentic hadith that the example, the parable of the believers towards one another when it comes to their mercy towards one another is like one body. If one organ of this body complains, then the rest will also complain with fever and pain. So the same thing, this ummah of the Prophet ﷺ is one ummah. And that's why what happens in the East or in the West, a Muslim have an effect in his heart when he hears about another believer being hurt or whatever there is. He feels that mercy in his heart. And this is something that is rewardable by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the verse, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most beneficent, the most merciful, something that should show clearly in our affairs, in our lives. And while you are standing in the salah, witness this. And this is as the ulama, they say, so that we have the effect of Surah Al-Fatiha in our life. We talked about Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. That should bring, as we heard before, the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because He's the most perfect subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He is the Rabb. He is the provider, He is the creator of the heavens and the earth and all that exists. And then once you reached this verse, when you are in the salah, while you are in the salah, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, you have this hope for the mercy of Allah. You have this act of worship which is Ar-Raja. You hope for the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You do the good deed, then you hope for the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the rewards from Him subhanahu wa ta'ala while you are reciting this beautiful verse, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. And also we would think, how can we develop this feeling in our hearts? How can we have mercy towards others when we call them to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? This religion is a religion of mercy. For a person to be saved from the hellfire, we need to put things in the proper perspective. Mercy is not just in eating and drinking and having a pleasant life. The real mercy is when a person enters the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is the benefit of a person living his whole entire life in some form of luxury, but then once a person dies, he entered the hellfire? Where is the mercy then? The real mercy is when a person receives it in this life to be obedient to Allah, to be steadfast on the deen of Islam, to be saved from the hellfire. And this is our mission, our message as Muslims, is to convey this message of mercy to mankind, to save themselves from the hellfire by doing what? By worshipping the one that created them, by turning to Him alone, by following the way of the Prophet alayhi salatu wassalam. And this basically should be the effect in our lives when it comes to reading and reciting the Quran and pondering over these verses of the Quran. If we go through the creation of Allah, the things that we see, the things that we do not see, and we try to explain and to ponder over the effect of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in all of these creation of Allah, that takes a long time. But this is enough for us to ponder over and to live our life according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us, that we subject ourselves to the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We'll be right back after this break, inshallah.
أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ.
Who should you marry? When is it time for divorce? I want my children to love Islam, but I don't know how. The Quran and Sunnah has the answer to these questions and more. To find out what those answers are, check out Family Issues and see the difference clear guidance makes.
Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. Now we need to see what is the practical steps that we need to take to benefit from this one verse. And again, it took us a while for just one verse, although we need more if we want to go through the verses of the Quran that talks about the mercy of Allah, the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the effect of that in the life of the companions radiallahu anhum, because we always need to link the verses of the Quran with the life of the companions radiallahu anhum, because they understood the Quran in the most perfect way. The practical benefits that we can get when we recite Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, there are deeds to be done by the heart, there are deeds to be done with our own tongue, and there are deeds to be done with the rest of our bodies. With the heart, of course, as we talked about it, we need to believe in the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need to believe in these names and attributes of Allah and in the vast mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we need to have that belief, that we need to subject ourselves to the mercy of Allah in all of our actions. That we believe that to enter Jannah we need the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need that mercy on the face of earth, that the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encompasses everything. We also, when it comes to the belief in the heart, that we need to have the strong intentions that we would have this effect, whatever in our hearts, on our outside appearance, when it comes to dealing with others, to have mercy towards others, to have mercy towards the closest one to us, the wife, the husband, the parents, the children. And there are many evidences in the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ that orders with practical examples of how to have this mercy. When a companion of the Prophet ﷺ, he said that I have 10 children and I never kissed one of them. And the Prophet ﷺ said to him, in the meaning of which, what would I do in the case of someone that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken away from his heart mercy? And he said to him, مَنْ لَا يَرْحَمِ النَّاسِ, whoever is not having mercy towards the human beings, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not have mercy towards him. So if we want to receive the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we need to have mercy towards others, especially those who are close to us. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, خَيْرُكُمْ خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ وَأَنَا خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ, that the best among you are the best to his family, to the closest people to him. And he said alayhi salatu wasalam, and I'm the best to my family. So this is a practical thing for us. And that comes in our speech, in the way that we speak, in the way that we act. We remember that we need to have this mercy towards one another. The same thing when it comes to those who are a bit away from us, our neighbors, those who live in our neighborhood, for the people that we see in the masajid, the believers, and also for even the disbelievers, for them to get to know the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran and in the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, for them to accept the truth, to accept the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of this is practical things for us to understand how to apply the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we talk about practicality when it comes to the verses of the Quran, it's basically, if it's something present in the heart and we follow the way of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, in our outside appearance and all of our actions, this is what the benefit that we would receive as a result of reciting the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Quran. Also, from this benefit that we would get when we recite Surah Al-Fatiha, when we recite the verses that talks about the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that the biggest mercy and the best mercy that a person can receive, again as we mentioned before, is for the person to enter the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it makes us see things in the proper way. The things that would be means for us to be saved from the hellfire, this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. And this is what we need to raise our children to witness this mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we need to recite the Quran, because the Quran is a mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we need to see that for people to recite the Quran, for people to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is all signs of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He has for us. We usually in this last segment take some of the questions that we receive. And one of these questions with regards to some of the verses of the Quran that a person might recite and he would find some form of contradictions. Of course, there's no contradictions when it comes to the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But one verse will mean one thing, and then in another place of the Quran, a person might recite the first and the apparent meaning of it might give him opposite meanings. And there are examples of this. How is that? To answer this question first, of course, we believe that there is no contradictions whatsoever in the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The contradictions is in the minds of some of the people because of the lack of knowledge. But when a person ponders over the verses of the Quran, sometimes something might be abrogated, which is some of the issues that are mentioned in the book of knowledge. And this is how the religion of Islam with the orders of Allah has been revealed in a gradual form. So, for example, you would recite a verse in the Quran that talks about the non-permissibility for a person to pray while in the state of intoxication. So someone reciting this verse might think that it's okay then to be intoxicated outside the salah. Of course, this is not the case. Why? Because there are other verses in the Quran that forbids drinking wine, for example, and intoxications at all times. So this verse was revealed in a gradual form, that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbidden drinking wine and alcohol for the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, it was done in a gradual form. So at first, they were forbidden from praying while in the state of intoxication, preparing them for the verses to come to forbid them from drinking it altogether. And this is the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So being believers, of course, we see this. Of course, there's no contradiction. This is something that is abrogated. Sometimes certain meanings might be mentioned in general terms in a part of the Qur'an, and it's mentioned in more specific terms in other parts of the Qur'an. For example, verses in the Qur'an that talks about the non-permissibility for the Muslims to marry from the disbelievers. But then you would have another verse in the Qur'an, like in Surah Al-Ma'idah, given the permissibility to a special type of the disbelievers, like the Jews and the Christians. And this is something that is not contradiction whatsoever, but this is a special case when it comes to the general rulings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in another verse. But of course, this is a different subject. But the point is, we need to be warned from something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Qur'an in Surah Ali Imran. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the beginning of the surah mentioned that those who have diseases in their hearts, and it's not physical diseases, but the disease of doubt, the disease of disbelief, hypocrisy, whatever there is, they follow the unclear or the non-clear verses in the Qur'an. The verses that might mean more than one thing, they would follow these verses so that they would reach whatever they seek from the Qur'an. The Qur'an, as we mentioned before, it has general terms in many verses. And as Umar radiallahu anhu, he said, حَمَّالُ أَوْجُهُ, meaning that it has more than one meaning. A verse might give you more than one meaning. How would you make it precise to whatever meaning that is correct? According to the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, according to the application of the verse in the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, and in the lives of the companions radiallahu anhum. So we need to have this very tightly mentioned and very close when it comes to the understanding of the Qur'an. We cannot understand the Qur'an like this as a standalone thing. It doesn't work this way. We have to understand the Qur'an with the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, with the life of the companions radiallahu anhum. These verses were never something in theory, but it was practiced by the companions of the Prophet ﷺ. It was established. People ruled by the verses of the Qur'an, by the laws of Allah. And humanity saw this mercy in their life. So how the justice from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can be served when the Qur'an would rule over them by the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So as a result of that, we have to take the whole Qur'an as a whole, not just one verse and we ignore the others, or take one verse that can mean more than one thing and we would say, see, then this is means that it's permissible for me to do this or that. Of course, we need to ask the people of knowledge. We need to make it related very closely to the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, since all is revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the practicality of the companions radiallahu anhum. So this is something that should be clear in our affairs, in our life. And again, when we refer back to Surah Al-Fatiha, we can basically refer everything back to Surah Al-Fatiha, since this is the best surah or the most virtuous surah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed. And to give a small summary of what has been mentioned before, although we just recited Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. And we took the time in explaining these meanings because we are in so much in need of it. Because we need it every time we stand in the salah. We need it in every day of our life. And that's why it's something that might be repeated later on also when we come to the other verses in the Qur'an. But this is the foundation. Surah Al-Fatiha is a foundation for the rest of the Qur'an, in which we would have the proper understanding and the proper belief in all of what we say. We learned about the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that you would see in these two verses of Surah Al-Fatiha, the belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the oneness of worship, in the oneness of lordship, and in the oneness of names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The oneness of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we heard Alhamdulillah. And the word Allah, it means the one to be worshipped with perfect submission and the perfect love. So this is the oneness of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rabbil Alameen, which gives us the meaning that He is the only one, He is the only Rabb, He is the only creator, He is the only sustainer, He is the only provider, and so on and so forth. He is the owner of all things. And we get the oneness of the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when we would recite Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most merciful subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most beneficent. And we would see that the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most perfect, of course. It's not the like of the attributes of the human beings. The human beings are full of deficiencies, but the creator of the heavens and the earth is the most perfect. And that's one of the things that we need to witness when we're reciting the Qur'an. We would go one after the other with the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and ponder over its meanings and see the effect of that in our hearts as Muslims, and to see that the rewards of things are given from the same sort of deeds that people do. If you have mercy towards others, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would have mercy towards you. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam had so much mercy towards his ummah. That's why he alayhi salatu wasalam made the dua, made the effort for this deen to be spread throughout the face of earth. And the same thing for the companions radiallahu anhum. And we should take this and be honored by the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that as a right on us to hold fast to it and to convey it to others and to teach others about the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran and in the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. After that, we would get to more meanings when it comes to the next verse, which is Maliki Yawm al-Din, the owner of the Day of Judgment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the owner of the Day of Judgment. It gives you the combination when it comes to the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Day of Judgment and the owner of the Day of Judgment, inshallah ta'ala. We'll talk about it next time in more details. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one to be worshipped, and He is the only one subhanahu wa ta'ala that we seek help from. And that we seek help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be steadfast on the sirat, on the straight path. That this salat has not been left like that for people to figure it out. And this is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But it's left for what is mentioned in the Quran and the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, for people to find out about the salat, to be steadfast on the salat, which is the way of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Classifying the human beings on the face of earth into categories for us to choose which category that we want to be among. Would we want to be among the category of the believers, or the category of the hypocrites, or the category of the disbelievers? And once the characteristics of the three groups are clearly mentioned, and this is the mercy of Allah, it's all there in the Quran, for the person to choose, and we have this ability to choose by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then definitely the right decision should be that we choose to be in the side of the believers, to have the characteristics of the believers, to stay away from the characteristics of the disbelievers, and to enjoin good and forbid evil, and to recite the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with this intention. We need to bring the Qur'an into our lives. We need not to keep the Qur'an on shelves in which the dust will cover it. We need to act according to the Qur'an. We need to have daily functions, daily jobs when it comes to the Qur'an. And we call it jobs. Why? Because it's more important than the materialistic jobs that we do on the face of earth. We're not asked to do this 24 hours a day, even 8 hours a day, but at least for a few minutes every day that we open the Qur'an, that you look into the verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and with the intention of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from me while I'm reciting this verse. How is the effect of that in our life, in my life, every day? This is the attitude that we should develop when we're reciting the Qur'an. If you know how to recite the Qur'an, and this is again, it's levels. If you're a new Muslim, if you're someone that don't have the ability to recite the Qur'an in the most perfect way, we need to start something in which you would be able to recite the Qur'an in the most perfect way. And be patient, because it's all rewardable from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know how to recite? Why not try to memorize the Qur'an, one verse at a time? Even if it takes many years, even if you don't finish the Qur'an, but still to be among those who are working on memorization of the Qur'an, to act according to the Qur'an. And this is the purpose of pondering over the verses of the Qur'an and going deep in depth to extract the beautiful meanings that are mentioned by our ulama in the explanations of the verses of the Qur'an. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who are the people of the Qur'an, and for us to receive the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and that we all enter the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Till next week, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept our deeds. Until then, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا
أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا
أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا